Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of our podcast, A Little More Light. We have a very special guest with us. He's none other than the founder and director of insightsias, Mr. Vinay Kumar GB. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Your English is very good.
Thank you, sir. Today it has grown on to become like pioneers in the field of UPSC, and we have branches in 5 cities of India.
So what I was good at was talking individually. I am really interested in knowing people, helping people. I never consider today as an end in something. I always consider myself as imperfect.
What is your advice to students?
One thing I tell all the students, take things really easy. Not to have ambitious targets. I just wanted to settle down in life. When you have patience, qualities, abilities, the time, you know, is very kind. I used to go by walk. I was living in a small room. 1 year, 8 months, I worked as a panchayat development officer. After 6 months, we got salary. I'm very funny in my home. I try to dance and I don't dance. When nobody is there, I put.
Oh, you do? Sir, who is your dream guest for the podcast? Sir?
Amit Shah, maybe sometime. I really want to talk to you. Such a great personality. I think so much. When you really want to achieve bigger things, automatically noise will be shut.
Thank you so much for being now a wonderful boss. Team Insights, grateful to you. It's like a video game. You're crossing like levels by levels. Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of our podcast, A Little More Light. Today we have a very special guest with us. Who, you may ask? Well, he's a proud Navodian, a family man, an exemplary mentor who has been behind the success story of several UPSC aspirants. And now he's a podcaster too. He's none other than the founder and director of insightsias, Mr. Vinay Kumar GB. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Your English is very good.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
We're so glad to finally have you an episode of our podcast, sir. We've tried so hard to get you here. We've had several emails and comments like, where is Vinay, sir? Where is Vinay, sir? Why is Vinay, sir, not, you know, why are we not interviewing you? So we're finally glad to have you here. And, you know, several aspirants consider you as, you know, this great mentor and as a great teacher. But you've always told us that, you know, you do not consider yourself as a teacher. So why is that, sir?
I mainly consider myself as a mentor. More like a guide, more like a friend to everyone who comes to seek any kind of guidance, whether it is related to preparation or related to life itself. So people come to seek suggestions, advices regarding life issues also. So I feel good about it. Teacher, I don't know, like maybe because I grew up in Navodaya school, we had teachers who taught us for many years, and we have a kind of image of these teachers, no? Who teach so well, who are more than life kind of figures, right? So I believe I haven't reached that stage yet. We're using word like great teacher, great mentor, and all. I think I don't consider myself as anything great. So I'm not saying this to sound humble or anything. I truly believe that I don't consider myself as, you know, a great teacher or a mentor. It's a journey, like it's still, I'm in the process of learning many things, becoming better in everything, better mentor, better guide. Teacher, I think it is the highest stage of imparting education, not in terms of, you know, knowledge, but also in terms of wisdom. So I think maybe after 10 years, 20 years, I'll call myself as a teacher.
So do you think like there's a stage where you get to call yourself a teacher? Like I believe that everybody is like teaching us something, like everybody we interact with. You've said it many times that, you know, you learn a lot from your students and from people you interact with, because you constantly interact with people, several people daily. So do you not like feel like everybody is a teacher in their own way?
So in that sense, it's true. I think I have tweeted about it also. I learn from everyone. From that perspective, everyone is a teacher. But when you ask a question to me that, you know, because we are in this field, either pretending like big teachers, great teachers, good teachers, popular educators, right?
Yeah.
So from that perspective, personally, I believe I'm still not in that stage, like where I can tell myself, I can claim myself that, you know, I'm a teacher.
I think a lot of people would, you know, beg to disagree with that. But you've also tweeted, sir, like you said you you know, when you came to the teaching field, you started an offline batch in 2016 or 2015. 2014 was your first offline like batch in a government school. And then, you know, you started a big OGP program in 2016. So you said that, you know, you did not have, you know, any skills, or you said you don't have any talents or lack of communication skills.
I literally
skills.
Lacked everything. So not much teaching experience, because I was teaching in Mysore. Teaching what? Current affairs to students like 10 to 15. And I used to get very few classes because I was not good in teaching. So what I was good at was talking individually, right? Because I really show interest. I'm really interested in knowing people. I'm really interested in helping people. So if words can help, I like to spend time, you know, speaking to them. So I'm always a kind of a private person who was comfortable, you know, speaking directly with one student or two students at a time. So now I can speak to thousands of audience also.
You didn't have the requisite skills. Like today, if we talk about a teacher, right. The communication skills, or you always say, you know, that you don't know English well even today. And you don't know how to teach so well.
That was a message, you know, ki you don't have to possess everything to succeed in life. Of course, I don't consider myself as a fully successful. But when you look at literally millions of aspirants who write the exam, don't make it into civil services. Yeah. Going by their numbers, relatively, I am successful. That again is not because I possess great skills. Either in communication, either in speaking, you know, English fluently with an accent, or very good teaching skills or anything. I attribute mainly these small success to certain qualities, right? As I mentioned earlier, you know, talking to people genuinely, you know, showing genuine interest in helping others.
Yeah.
And I think I possessed some amount of knowledge, I think. So whenever I spoke to an individual, they might have benefited from it. And they would have told another person, they came. And that is how things built up.
That's
and
how
I was decently good in writing skills.
Yeah.
I think the website got popular because of my posts and certain new ideas. I think it's because of certain ideas and some amount of writing skill, things became popular.
So, you know, when we look back on your journey, we see that you may not have possessed like all the, you know, checked, you know, you wouldn't have ticked off all the requisite skills. But you knew certain things and you pursued them with a lot of passion and dedication. Like, you know, there's a tweet where, you know, you were getting married and the same morning at 7 a.m. you tweeted, you posted secure questions. So, you know, you showed an extreme level of dedication. You used to work for 18 hours a day initially. So we see that, you know, while you may not possess all the skills, just do what you're doing and try becoming better at them. Well, also
that is the essence. Like, yeah. You know, I never consider myself even today as an end in something.
Yeah.
I always consider myself as imperfect. Want to learn many things. For example, I want to learn dancing. Like,
yeah.
For example, I don't know a single
fun step. Fact, everybody. Sir had this childhood dream that he wants to become a dancer and singer. He has it even today. So are you planning to start
if
learning,
people
sir?
Are imagining me dancing and singing. It will be maybe weird thing, but from school days, because in school, you know, they were not giving me opportunity. Only English medium and other students from cities were getting, because they were already good in doing that. I think I should not be blaming, you know, only their English medium or anything, but they were not giving us chances. I wanted to do that, and after school I didn't get chance to do them. And even this English speaking and all, you know, we were not given chances of debating and other things. So I found comfort in, you know, sometimes quiz competition, or mostly in writing competitions. I feel that, you know, I need to learn new things, and I want to learn. I'm passionate about learning new things. So whether it is spoken English, this podcast, for example, is also to add another dimension to my life. I want to kind of tell people that, you know, so life happens on the go.
Yeah.
Right? We learn things on the go. Sometimes we succeed, sometimes we fail, but we should never stop trying the new things. And we never know that, you know, this, for example, this podcast, I don't know. It might fail, it might succeed. I don't know absolutely about anything. But it might also become a source of livelihood. I don't know. If other things fail, I don't know. Like, it can be a possibility, right? Similarly, like if I learn dance, for example, right? And if I get better in dancing, so I can, you know, live life dancing.
So then you'll give competition to Vicky Kaushal, sir. We get a lot of comments like, you know, Vicky Kaushal, Ram Charan. I've sent you the screenshots. So it's like...
So they should be insecure. No. I don't have... I'm ambitious, but honestly...
Sir, we see this trait in you,
sir. But I feel good,
sir.
Like when people say these things, I show them to my wife.
Okay.
Where she thinks that, you know, I'm none of them.
So, sir, like we see this trait in you, okay? You may not, like, you know, I'm just saying, you may not be good at a lot of things, which you say it yourself. And, but you're not afraid to try them out. Like, let's say, you know, you say you're not good at English, but you're not afraid to come, okay, I want to start a podcast and I want to do it in English. You know, I will learn on the way. I will take criticism. I will take the feedback and I will use that as fuel to grow. And that's an attitude we see, like, in every initiative, you know, since you started your blog, like, even through maybe your UPSC journey, which we will cover later. So that is the attitude which has, I think, brought you where you are today and will take you further. So, you know, what is your advice to students like, you know, who are struggling, who are insecure today? You know, they're insecure about not knowing English. They're insecure about not being, you know, as good as a topper. So they have several insecurities. Look, like, what would be your, you know, advice for them, sir?
Like, there are many advisors, right? One thing I tell all the students all the time, whenever they come and meet me, is to take things really easy, in the sense that not to have ambitious targets, not to have big plans, not to have any expectations. The focus must be on learning, right? From day one to till the last day you write the exam, and even after passing also, even if you don't pass. So can you learn anything from every experience, right? And then secondly, the passion should be there. So you might find that out of so many things you are doing, you might be more passionate about something, right? So which you can keep it as a reserve and then later explore once if you cannot make UPSC. But if there is no passion, you will never find out what you are good at, right? Yeah. So what you really love doing. We never used to write answers. I used to do blogging, but I used to do it in like midnight, like, I don't know, like I never saw that time, like, right? Though I used to sleep like 8 hours or something, but there was so much passion, I never used to know when the time was flying or anything. When people come with essays and answers, I see an excitement, right? So somebody is able to create something out of, you know, nothing. They might have little information, they are able to extrapolate and think, apply, and bring their creativity onto the paper, show it to, you know, the world. So these are all exciting things. So if there is passion, excitement, then I don't think they will ever face any kind of, you know, stress, depression or anything.
So that's how, like, we see you had a lot of hobbies, like even when you're trying for UPSC, one was obviously blogging and sketching and, you know, several things like that. And you actually use that now, you know, to, when all the doors shut down, like you did not have any, you didn't clear UPSC, you cleared KPSC, but even there was a huge block there. So now you were rejected from everywhere else. But then, you know, this was a pathway for you, like all your hobbies, you utilize them and, you know, you nurture them and you made this a big thing today, you know, just from a blog in like 2008. Today, InsightsIAS has branches in like 5 major cities of India. So what started as a, you know, passion project, your blog, which was Win to Win first. Win to Win is basically Vinay Sir to win. So Win to Win. And then it was Insights on India. And now it's, you know, today it has grown on to become like one of the, you know, pioneers in the field of UPSC test preparation. And we have branches in 5 cities of India. So we really learn how to, you know, take what we're good at and, you know, really work on it and shine in that field. And I think that, like, people should learn how to take a chance on themselves and their talents. And I think that is somewhere a lot of people act like we're so afraid to take risks.
So it happened not only because of talent or passion or interest. I was fortunate to find good people.
Okay.
Right. So all of it was possible because of team effort, not because of one individual, right? Mm. So the passion was there. I think others might have seen the same passion. They related with it. They connected with it. And then they became part of it. So those who came to Insights, became part of Insights, except very few have stayed with us, you know, from day one. And if at all somebody had moved out, it's because either they got into IAS, they got into state services, so other things. But by choice, almost nobody has left Insights.
So, sir, now that you spoke about your team, like, we see that, you know, if you see the InsightsIAS family, the team is like handpicked by you, most of them, like almost all of them actually, and mostly your ex-students. And we see they all, you know, they share the same intention, the same motivation to serve the aspirant community. Like, we are somebody, we don't run after profits. Like, yes, of course, we charge things, but we'll always have this free initiative, or we charge, you know, we keep prices like very affordable. So how do you pick your team? Like, you know, how do you pick similar people? It's like, how do you build team
insights? So I focus on trustworthiness.
Okay.
So can I trust this person with when I give them responsibility? Secondly, I look into values. Like, are they humble? Do they practice humility? Because humility is something that I see fundamental in any human, you know, to be associated with. Because if they're not humble, I don't think they will do justice to students' expectations, right? I don't want anyone in my institutions to be treated poorly, badly.
Yeah.
So anyone who comes, they should be respected. They should be given importance, irrespective of whoever it is. They might have failed a number of times. They might be wearing really very poor clothes. They may be from very poor background. They may be from very poor academic background. They may not be performing well even in test. But they might have succeeded as well. In addition to these two, I see, can they be like dependable in terms of if I give them extra work, right? Can they take on themselves any extra work and do it, you know, more than what is required? I think the responsible thing. So they should feel responsible for the institution, for the students. So if I feel that, you know, they can go extra mile, they are proactive, I think. And that is how the team is built. And so fortunate that almost everyone is like that. There are many people who work till in the evening. I don't tell them. In fact, there is no fixed timing in the institution. Right? They come anytime.
Yeah.
I don't do job interviews.
Yes.
I don't, like, I just talk 5 to 10 minutes, random things. I think I'm good at sensing people, you know, what they are, who they are, I think.
Yes.
Maybe I might be good in that.
So, sir, not a lot of people know this, but you've told me this. So, you know, you you want to become a teacher after, you know, failing in all your UPSC attempts. You went to this principal, I think a school principal, and you want to start teaching at that school, but he rejected you. He didn't think you could teach, and also that you did not have the, you know, degree to teach. So do you feel like, you know, all those rejections, the, you know, people rejected you as a teacher in several other places, and then you're like, you know what, I don't want to like go teach somewhere else. I'm going to start my own initiative. And this, you started this blog, and I've read the post from like your archive.
The blog was already there, but it was a personal blog.
Yeah.
While doing blogging, I was trying with other things. I just wanted to settle down in life with anything that could earn, you know, like 5 to 10,000 in a month.
Okay.
So regarding the school experience, its name is college, not in Bangalore, like in Mysore. I think till plus two, the school is there. It was near to my home. So we had shifted to Mysore by then. Because I had started teaching to UPSC students, I had got courage that, you know, I could do to school students also. So at that time, I had only BSc degree. So no, I had dropped 5 master's degree. I had enrolled. I did like 1 sem, 2 sem, and then I think this is the story with most of the UPSC aspirants even today. They enroll for many post-graduation, they don't complete.
Which master's degree did you enroll for, sir?
So one MA English Literature.
5 degrees, right?
MA Political Science,
oh.
MSc Organic Chemistry, MA Media and Cultural Studies, and MA public administration. In the end, I enrolled, but of course, I didn't start studying at all. Three were related to the options that I was trying in UPSC. I went to that school. There was this principal. I told him that he treated me kindly, actually. I told him that I'm interested in teaching. I went till UPSC interview and I'm teaching for UPSC students. But I feel comfortable teaching to class 8, 9 students. If you can just give me a demo, I will teach any subject. So because I was science graduate, I had studied social science. Again, same like any UPSC aspirant with so much experience can do this. But he asked me one question. Do you possess B.Ed. degree? Bachelor in education, I think. I said, I don't possess it. Then he said, rules won't allow us to, give chances to people without B.Ed. I didn't know that at that time. I was just like, it's a school, like neighborhood school. And why would anyone care? And I told him, I don't want even salary also.
Oh.
First 2-3 months, you can just try it out. If I don't do justice, you can just send me back. He was like adamant, only with degree we will give you a chance. Maybe he judged me by my appearance. Like, at that time, I used to wear whatever, like slipper and all those things. Yeah, I went without shoes and all. Maybe by appearance, you might have judged. Or maybe I lacked confidence in conveying things, right? So he didn't give me that opportunity. And that memory stayed with me in a positive way. Right. I take all these kind of rejections in a positive way, that life is kind of a cycle. For example, in future, I would like to have my own school, very big school, where I would like to give opportunities to more number of people. And in UPSC, like in InsightSias, I'm doing that. So whoever comes with a request, I don't reject anyone. I ask them to give a demo. If they are doing justice, then we will give an opportunity. If we'll give another demo, like they will give more opportunities. If they are giving quality, we take them. If they're not giving quality, I ask them, you get experience from different institutions. They may be accommodative as of now, and then you can come back later because students are a bit demanding here.
So, sir, now you got rejected by the principal. So,
I don't see it as a rejection, was kind of another motivation to think big.
Was this pushing you on to the right path actually now?
Correct.
Today, when you look back in hindsight.
It's not a rejection.
Yeah.
So he might have his own thinking, his own interest or something, but I see it as part of the growth process.
Like you can connect the dots today. So sir, this led you on to, start your own UPSC, let's say online blogging, and you became a teacher. Like everyone started addressing you as sir. You said you started posting blogs, educative blogs and stuff. People started addressing you, sir, and then began, your journey in this UPSC mentorship. So how has that been? Like, how did it come about? And, what was your experience when you started first?
I honestly didn't start with an idea that I wanted to become a teacher.
Okay.
I went for a model where there was no teaching, in the beginning. So it was purely test-based approach where I was giving hundreds of tests to those 40 students whom I selected through an entrance in our first offline batch. I wanted to avoid teaching. That's why I didn't go with the teaching, teaching approach, conventional. Second reason why I wanted to avoid teaching was not because I was poor in that, because I knew that it was not going to work, because it was spoon feeding kind of stuff. I didn't want to make students dependent on teachers. So I wanted to make them self-dependent. So started giving them targets and, big timetable, so many tests. The same model is continuing today also. And that is how it started. The experience was that the students started getting attached. And attached in a way that I had never felt that in my life before, right? Because I didn't have good teaching experience before that. So in a way, the experience is rewarding in the sense that students who have benefited from my guidance or whatever it is, have been grateful and have experienced it. The recent trip to Delhi, Agra. So I see that, you know, they're coming, helping me. It happens everywhere, every time.
So, sir, we have a surprise for you from one of your first students, from your first batch, which firstly, you run the first batch at a government school, right?
Yes.
So, not a lot of people know about that. Could we have the clip?
I'm happier to note that you're one of the guests for the same. So, on this occasion of Teachers' Day, I wish you a very happy Teachers' Day. And I'm thankful to the Insights team for having given me an opportunity to wish you on through this video and also to share my thoughts. My association with you and with Insights dates back to 2014-15 when Insights was still a website and it was still in its nascent stages. So back then, and I'm forced to go back in my memory line and also to recollect a few things actually. According to me, a teacher for IAS preparation is one who has two important traits. One is foresight and the second one is commitment. By foresight is meant a trainer should be able to predict as to what kind of questions would come and guide aspirants accordingly. Perhaps when UPSC started with the new pattern for GS mains, you were one of the very few tutors in the entire country who were able to understand the needs and demands of UPSC, and you gave test series like that only because we were made to write more questions in less time. So that was one thing which helped almost all of us to do very good writing practice, and we were able to finish the paper and most of us were able to secure very high marks in GS. So on the second one is commitment. See, perhaps the number of tests that were given by Insights was very power packed. At least we were being given 2 to 3 tests every week. And there were about 25 students, 25 into 3 you amounted to about 75 test papers, and you had to evaluate everybody. And you put your heart and soul into it, and you evaluated every paper, and you used to guide us, guide every aspirant without any, I must say, very thoroughly and deeply. So I still remember and recall a few days when you used to call me in the night where we used to roam and we used to walk in the RPC layout streets and Hampinagar streets, where we used to stand beneath a street light and where you used to give me a lot of tips, guidance, etc., etc. Perhaps that amount of commitment, that amount of foresight are two important traits that has made you what you are today. So once again, happy Teachers' Day, sir. And on this occasion, I pray the God Almighty to bless you with health, happiness, as well as strength to guide more and more aspirants in their journey towards IAS. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Balaji. So it feels really great, you know. So I didn't know that you had done all these things. So, but to again, he also took me to back to memory lane. So what he said is right. You know, we used to stand below a street light, like wherever. I mean, it's not because we didn't have light. I used to do walking and all. I used to go by walk. I was living in a small room. Sometimes I used to invite these people to my room, and I was a bachelor then, so I didn't have anything else to do. So whatever he's saying, all the commitment and everything, basically I didn't have anything to do. So I was just evaluating, I was creating content, I was blogging, you know, so all the secure initiative and all. It feels so happy to not to listen to his Happy Teacher Day message, but to see where he is now. So he's a municipal commissioner of Tirupati. He's Balaji, and land of Balaji. He's municipal commissioner, and that is such a big responsibility. And the way he has evolved, you know, as a good administrator, good human being, and he has stayed humble even today. And most of the first, everyone in the first batch, you know, who got ranks, are still in touch with me every day. I don't call them regularly. If at all I am visiting UP and I'm calling Madhusudan Ulgi, he immediately picks the call and he talks, and whenever he gets transferred, he messages me, updates me. Same with Nitish K. So he's in Deputy Secretary, Finance Ministry, Karnataka. It's a very good post for his age and, you know, his batch. And he's in regular touch. You know, he's all of them respect. And your first batch is always special. And this message was really special. Thank you.
You're welcome, sir. You know, they actually believed in you. Like today we have the infrastructure, we have branches, you know, we have So it's easy to get students today.
Correct.
But they believed in you when you literally had, you know, this rented classroom in a government school.
It feels very strange, you know, like I thought about it many times.
Yeah.
That why did these people trust me?
Yeah, it is. Right.
Why did these people, you know, I didn't have any kind of background, you know, any experience.
Yeah.
There was only this website and they hadn't seen me at all. There was no picture of me anywhere and no video of mine anywhere. I don't know. I put a post that I was going to start this offline initiative. Got hundreds of applications. Then I got only 40 admissions because I was scared to take more people. What if I do some injustice to them?
Mm-hmm.
Right. I wanted to take only those many students for whom I could do some justice. And I still wonder, and almost everyone was from, like, except like three, Balaji and like other three, four people, everyone was from outside Karnataka. And from every part of India, they came to Bangalore, you know, packing their luggage and everything. This was back in 2014, January 2014. Still wonder, like, you know, how did that happen? And I'm happy that most of them are well settled. Most of them got UPSC ranks, this respective state services. Some of them went back and, you know, doing great jobs in their chosen careers.
So he mentioned two qualities of yours, sir, commitment and foresight. And we see that, you know, this has led you to be very successful even today. Like, you had like extreme commitment initially. You used to work 18 hours a day. On the day of your marriage, you know, at 7 a.m., you put up secure posts. So you showed like total integrity and commitment to what you were taking up. And, you know, you evaluated their papers personally, every single paper. So you gave it your all, like you gave it your 100%. And I think Insights was not an accident. It was not like a, you know, a chance thing. You really worked at it. You know, you did work at it. And you also had a lot of foresight. Like, you started, you were the pioneer in, you know, starting answer writing initiatives. So you also had this foresight, sir. Like, you know, how do you, like, you know, you're like this visionary. You know what's like, you keep in touch with trends. Like podcasts, it's a new thing. Like, no one in the UPSC realm has started it as yet.
There's nothing visionary about it. Like, in other fields people are doing, I felt like I keep talking to students and I have heard so many stories about struggles, happy stories also. I thought, why not give it a wider audience, right?
Yeah.
So bring diverse people here, talk to them. If I'm doing something in my cabin every day, right? The same thing I can do here. And you people have set up a beautiful podcast room. I don't know, like, it's really beautiful.
Thanks, sir.
So I don't know if it was really necessary. People would have gone with one simple thing, but it really looks great. And the first two episodes have really come out well. And as you know, we are committed to it and it's part of growth also. I mean, learning.
Do you think you've redefined what an ideal teacher is? Like, you didn't have this, you know, you did not do this conventional teaching on a board, in a classroom. You start an online blog. So have you redefined, you know, who a teacher is?
I don't think in that way, like, you know, who am I to redefine anything? But yeah, the role of teacher should not be restricted to explaining students' concepts, imparting knowledge. The role of teacher should be beyond the classroom, outside the classroom, in molding personality such that, you know, the students lead a successful life even if they fail in the exam. It's not just like giving motivation lectures also, being with them, you know, supporting them and understanding them correctly, understanding them properly, being a guiding light. So I think that should be the true role of a teacher rather than, and also they should be role model in themselves in the sense that, you know, the children, now I have two kids, they learn mimicking their parents. So if I am a good person, they will also go on to become good citizens. Similarly, I think in the UPSC field also, we should be role models, you know, how we conduct, how we treat others, how we treat especially those who fail in this examination. So in that way, I'm trying to do my little bit. If you think it has redefined, then I'm happy to take that credit.
Yes, sir, you have. Like, see, today, like, it's very rare that, you know, students keep in touch with their teacher or their mentor from like 8-9 years ago. And, you know, they still have so much respect for you.
Like, you know, there are institutions, there are teachers before us. But yeah, in a way that with respect to life, keeping in touch, you know, even now certain officers who are already in service, they talk about life. So I think in that way, maybe it is different.
As you said, you lead by example, like whether it's students who meet you, like whenever, you know, anyone sitting in your cabin, you're like this calm person, you're like this Buddha, you just sit and people come with all their problems. And I think everybody walks out with a smile and, you know, you give them, you provide them with so much solace.
So many discounts. I get. They walk out with a smile.
But I think your words, like, you know, they really have a very calming effect and, you know, they really help people.
Thank you.
So, sir, what are the five major learnings that you had in your life? Like, if you have to speak about those which really impacted you and transformed you and, you know, made you who you are today.
The first learning is don't take anyone anything for granted. So, this is my biggest learning. I mean, take everyone seriously. Treat everyone fairly. Give respect to everyone. Second learning is humility. You know, be humble all the time with everyone, right? Earlier, you know, I was not doing it consciously. Like, in the sense, I am humble by nature because of all the growth I had in school before that, after school, college and everything, all the experiences and also upbringing. My parents are humble. Everyone around me are humble. Now, I am humble by nature, but at the same time, even when there are arrogant people in front of me, I try to be humble, right? Even when it is slightly irritating, I don't reciprocate in an arrogant way. The reason is that humility rewards. It's a rewarding thing. Okay, this is second learning. Third is that irrespective of how much good you want to be, how much good you are doing, so there are always a few bad people, they will enter and, you know, exit your life. And you can't do anything about it. You have to just learn lessons out of these people and you have to block them. You have to totally avoid. So I have blocked few aspirants who became officers, who turned kind of very arrogant and, you know, very hostile or something. Employees also who were like that. So blocked, and it's a very peaceful life since then. Fourth learning is, you know, life is a cycle, right? In a way that you might not have something today, but when you are easy on yourself, kind to yourself, you always tend to get it later. The fifth learning, the biggest, is something about time, right? I consider time as something organic being. It's a weird concept I have. If I am kind to time, if I respect time, it reciprocates, right? That we should value time not in terms of, you know, saving time or, you know, having more time with us. We have to respect time for the very fact that there is time.
Like, yeah. Do what you can in the best way possible with the time you have available. Like, don't take it for granted.
Exactly. So that, you know, in a way, I think rewards you. Like, if I see time as an entity, you know, which is watching you, right? And if you are really respecting, valuing that, it favors you. That which we call as luck, which we call as some
opportunities,
kind of opportunities, you know, that I have experienced personally so many times. So on that basis, I have
learned this. Would you like to elaborate? So, like, how have you experienced it with like one or two instances?
Incidences, like, there is no like one incidence or anything. For example, there was a time when I felt I had nothing in the world, right? Literally nothing. So I lost job opportunities
in the aftermath of your UPSC failure. Yeah.
No big graduations, so multiple failures, life front and, you know, UPSC front, professional front. So when I had nothing, I was kind to myself. I told myself, apna time aayega, before the movie came, you know, अपना टाइम आएगा. सो आई ऑफ कोर्स आई डोंट डिडंट ट्रैप एंड ऑल दोस थिंग्स बट आई फेल्ट दैट यू नो माय टाइम विल कम. आई वाज वेरी पेशेंट. आई थिंक द पॉइंट इज पेशेंस. एंड लेटर ऑन यू नो थिंग्स स्टार्टेड कमिंग विदाउट मी आस्किंग फॉर इट. सो टुडे आई हैव सो मेनी थिंग्स. समटाइम्स आई फील लाइक आई हैव एवरीथिंग. ऑफ कोर्स पीपल वुडंट अग्री. यू नो समबडी ट्वीटेड दैट यू नो you're still growing, like you know, not fully successful. Even I believe I'm not fully successful, totally successful. There is so much to do in life, and definition of success varies from people to people. The thing is, when you have patience, when you equip yourself with certain qualities, abilities, the time, you know, is very kind to you. I think that concept of karma is also something to do with this concept of time. I think
it's like you just persevere through every hardship, every setback. Just be patient, you know.
So you're detached and you just experience them. You don't judge them. You don't try to escape from them. You just go through them. You know, you go, you feel pain, you get hurt, but you go through them. You go through in a way that you feel good about it later.
It's like a video game. You're crossing like levels by levels, you know, obstacles. Correct. So it becomes like a game and you're just flowing with it. You're not trying to like, you know, hide, you know, getting scared. Just go with it. Okay.
I really don't try to escape from it.
So sir, if not a teacher, who would you be?
I would be a filmmaker.
Nice.
I wanted to make movies.
Okay. And where did that stem from? Where did that
maybe
desire stem
possible,
from?
Maybe possible, you know, direct a movie. Not act. So people say I look like
Vicky Kaushal, sir.
Johnny Lever and all those things.
No, sir. Vicky Kaushal, Ram Charan,
recently
Prabhu Deva.
A topper, you know, in Agra told me that, topper's wife. Okay. Rana Duggubati.
Oh, yeah.
He's a villain. Like, you know, I said, I don't look like a villain.
No, he doesn't look like a villain. So basically, several actors, like, we keep getting comments over comments.
So anyway, like, it's, when someone is successful, I think people start seeing them, you know,
in a new light. No,
in a new light. But I, it might sound arrogant, but I am who I am, right?
Yeah, true.
So want to carve my own identity later.
You're the best.
It will be good, like when they say that, you know, Vicky Kaushal looks like Vinay Sir.
I'm sure they will come a day like that.
That time might come, may not come, we don't know. But what is wrong in being ambitious?
Yes, sir. So you know, now that you're speaking about appearances, you tweeted like, you know, you'd gone to in Bangalore and, you know, they did not give you premier seating in the balcony because of your appearance. So how, you know, how...
So that was
how
my interpretation, but of course they didn't give, though they could have given. I would have given somebody because I had taken my wife for the first time to high-end restaurant. So I wanted a very good experience. So they didn't give. So that day I made up a mind that, you know, I will have my own restaurant someday.
Oh.
Or I will live in higher floor than this permanently. And then it happened later. It happened like 3 years after that incident.
Oh, wow.
So now I live in a penthouse on 28th, 29th floor combined. So I have the very good view of Bangalore. And of course, we see it every day. And I enjoy it every day. People see it, no? Like when it becomes familiar, you don't enjoy it. But every time I see it, I really enjoy it.
That's really nice. Like I've you've told me this, you know, several times, you know, just be silent and work through any setback, no matter what people tell you. Just keep working, you know, with your head down. Be silent and, you know, show them, like, you know. And I think
no,
that's
we have
what
to smile within inside, you know, when you are going through a bad experience, when someone is humiliating you, when you sense that someone is mistreating you, when someone is ridiculing you. You will feel that, right? When someone is not treating you well.
Yeah.
In that moment, we should not react. We should be silent. Smile inside. Apna time aayega. Like our time will come. And then just don't even, you know, mistreat them. Like in
don't react.
Don't react. So just you walk out and it might take little extra time.
So who would you say is your favorite teacher? Like who has shaped you and, you know, made you who you are today? Like we all have like this favorite teacher, someone who really inspired us or helped us in some way at some point in life. And, you know, it was a turning point for a lot of us. So who would you say, you know, is your favorite teacher?
So there are two teachers.
Okay.
So one teacher who really hit me hard when I pretend to smoke, you know, with peppermint shaped in a cigarette. Since then, of course, since then. So even when people were, you know, the circle was like that, I never smoked, I don't smoke, I will never smoke also. For that factor, I consider him as greatest teacher.
Nice.
Second is one Ramdas sir. So he was in my Navoday school. He was a chemistry teacher. So when I became school leader in class 11th, I didn't know what to do. So what were my responsibilities as a school leader? So he would always give me lecture that as a leader, how you should conduct yourself. What are your responsibilities? What you should demand from school management, school authorities? What you should be doing to the students? And so he instilled that confidence that, you know, this being captain of the school is a special position. And you have so many responsibilities. And he believed in me that, you know, I could do them. So I could see a transformation in my confidence, you know, from being very introvert. Even after my school, I was introvert and all. But in terms of handling situations, problems, juniors, students, teachers, he instilled me that confidence. So forever, I'm grateful because that was a really transformative experience for me.
And don't you see that you're doing the same thing to several students, like even if they may not meet you offline, like even online, you're doing the same thing. You instill confidence in people, like you encourage and support them. And, you know, they feel like they can conquer the world after meeting like several people, you know.
So that goes back to my first point, you know, don't take people for granted. The thing is, I believe everyone can do great things in their lives.
Yeah.
I truly believe that, you know, today they might appear totally useless, worthless. Even they might be feeling the same.
You said several people in your close circle always thought you were very dumb or useless, and, you know, they didn't expect much from you. But today,
even today, some people think that because maybe I appear like that, I look like that, I don't know. So I sense it sometimes, you know, very rarely now. You know, it is getting reduced as years are passing because I'm getting so much respect.
Adulation,
yeah. Other thing. But even then, sometimes I see that, okay, here and there. I don't know why people used to do that. But what I've learned is that we should give support, opportunities to everyone. Right? Here, like, I don't lose anything by, you know, encouraging people to be ambitious, to dream big things. I keep telling this to everyone. So it can be within my family, it can be whoever. So what is there to lose? You know, I relate it with my own life. Of course, there is so much to do, so much to achieve. But whatever little I have achieved can be easily achieved by anyone with slightly different thinking and being open to criticism, being open to feedback, and you know, being passionate about certain things.
I think one thing that differentiates you, sir, is that you were, you know, not afraid of taking a chance on yourself. Like, you were a risk taker. Like, today, if you, you know, ask any aspirant, like, you know, start an institute by yourself, I don't think a lot of people will have the guts to do it, you know, and you just took a chance on yourself. And I think that was a turning point for you.
What I see nowadays is that people take risk, people get investment and all. There are many companies who have succeeded in that also, but most of them want quick success, easy success. I think that is wrong with them. They do take risk, okay? But I think they should have patience. They should bring new ideas to, you know, students. And those who are bringing new things, they are succeeding. And of course, there are so many majority who never take any kind of risk.
But, you know, if you see today's perspective, like, everyone wants an MBA or a BE, like, before you starting an edtech startup. And you had none of them, right? You always say you're just a BSc graduate. So do you think that impacted how people perceive you initially? Or, you know, how did you have the guts to do it?
I used to have inferiority complex in the beginning.
Okay.
To tell people that I'm just a BSc graduate.
Yeah.
I used to refrain, you know, from telling. That was because when I left my MSc Organic Chemistry in between. So in 2005, I completed BSc. In 2006, I started doing MSc. It was in Bangalore University. It was a free seat and it was a good college within the university. When I left it and came home, all my father's friends were, you know, taunting and telling that why did you leave it? You should have plan B. You should have written UGC exam and then, you know, become lecturer and then researcher something and all. So I think at that stage, you know, when you are 21, 22, that stays with you. So for some time it affected that, you know, whenever people used to ask, I used to tell MSc, I'm doing MSc. And then when I had joined MA, this course and that course, I used to tell, I've joined this course, I'm doing this. But when I started this and after like 2 to 3 years, I made peace with the fact that graduation degrees are irrelevant. And so what is more important is you, you know, your abilities, your thinking, your qualities, right? So I really don't find anything wrong, any embarrassment in admitting to any weaknesses I have today. And these are not, of course, weaknesses.
Yeah, you're just like being yourself and, you know, owning it, like taking like acceptance, you know, taking responsibility for who you are. And you're very proud of it. Like you're not trying to hide any insecurity anymore. So I think that's something we all need to learn.
I'm not proud of it. I really want higher education.
Okay.
I feel like I should have really got higher education. I recommend people to get higher education. Yeah, just because degrees do not matter to me doesn't mean that, you know, they do not matter to them. They should go for higher education if there is an opportunity. And I always tell people to go for reputed universities. Do it from JNU, DU or Harvard, Oxford. If you have money and opportunities and talent, you go there. And then you can come back to UPSC also. So, and I have convinced many students after one or two attempts to pursue higher education in big institutions. And some of them might come back and prepare or might find their own areas of interest. Mm-hmm. But I'm not proud that, you know, I'm just a BSc graduate. But I'm not...
You're not ashamed of it. Like
I'm not ashamed also.
So I think that's something we all need to learn. Like just be yourself and be proud of who you are and, you know, what you're doing. And
yeah, I'm proud
of
who I am.
Yeah, actually. Pursue other things also. Like, so what are the 5 fun facts about yourself, sir?
5 fun facts about myself?
Yes.
I'm very funny. In my home.
Okay.
Right. I'm really funny. Like people don't see that in me, that I'm funny. So all serious videos and, you know, serious class lectures have made me look like a very serious person. I really crack jokes. I really play so much with my kids, fighting, you know, jumping with them from sofa on the floor.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So all my tummy and all. So but I do all this fun stuff with my kids. I really spend a quality time. Fun fact in the sense that I get hit a lot by them intentionally. My elder kid, 4.5-year-old, he actually thinks he's a Spider-Man right now.
Oh, the Spider-Man face we've seen photos, yes.
No, he thinks Spider-Man. If you ask him what is your name, he says Spider-Man. He doesn't say Vihan or anything. He actually says Spider-Man. And then he has to put, you know, web and all, no? So as soon as morning he wakes up, he puts web like this. So that has to fall on my face and then I have to do acting like, you know, it has fallen on my face and then I have to remove all web and I do it every day. I don't get tired of it. And then
that's really sweet.
And then, you know, he puts web and, you know, he drags me like this. I have to act like, you know, I'm dragged by a Spider-Man. So these things I do. And the small 1.5-year-old is also learning to, he doesn't speak a single word. Like he cannot speak it, right? He's still small kid. But if I ask you do Superman web, he also does like this, like Ambedkar showing one thing, you know, like that. He also puts web on me, but he doesn't know, like, beyond that. That is second thing. Third fun fact, I try to dance and I don't dance. I want to dance, right? When nobody is there, I put
oh, you do?
I put little music and I try to do 1 or 2 steps, you know. I mean, the YouTube video, try to mimic 1 or 2 steps, but I miserably fail. I don't do that. And the final fun fact about me, someday I would like to do stand-up comedy also.
Nice.
Like I think if I try, I can be good in that.
So you never know, next our show on Insights will be a stand-up comedy show to lighten the
mood
of aspirants. I think we should, sir.
If the students are willing to listen to our poor jokes, we can do it.
We'll try it next.
We'll do it.
So, sir, you achieved so much.
Not so much. Like, a little more I have achieved.
okay. A little as per your definition. So, what's your next ambition? So, you want to become a podcaster. Now you're a podcaster. What next?
I want to visit every country, like travel. Okay. I mean, these are in the bucket list. What to become? I really don't have a plan or anything, but I really have a big ambition that I don't want to settle for a normal,
ordinary.
Yeah. It's not normal, ordinary life. The life is normal per se. I really don't know. As I've experienced, if I'm getting better in myself, in my own personality development, in my own skills, abilities, I think the opportunities will come. Any big opportunity that comes, I will grab it.
Like, you want to open a school?
Huh, I want to open school. I want to open hospital. I want to have my own restaurant someday.
Nice. Right.
So these things are there. Again, these things are not like very big things. Beyond them also, there are bigger things. Maybe in future, we can reveal it.
So you basically like doing things out of your comfort zone. You don't, you want to grow every day with every opportunity.
More than growing or anything, I want to explore possibilities in life.
Like you keep tweeting, be open to possibilities.
Exactly. So life, keeps giving you so many opportunities, possibilities. So why not just experience it?
So now we see if people want to write the UPSC exam and they fail at it, but they're so they're only like seeing UPSC every day. They just see that. They don't see the several other opportunities there, passing by them. The
problem is they don't give themselves a little more time.
Yeah.
Right. So give yourself a little more time, like another 1, 2, 3 years, and do another higher education, develop certain skills. Right. It's okay not to be employed, not to earn money for some time being. Like it happened something like this, till age 31, I was not earning. Like briefly, 1 year, 8 months, I worked as a panchayat development officer between 2009 and 10. So that was the only time I was earning. And again, after 6 months, we got salary. And later that, the salary was intermittent. It was not regular. And I was getting around 14,000 rupees, right? And so didn't have money for things. But then I kind of persisted. The same thing UPSC aspirants who don't see other opportunities should do. Wait for your moment. So don't get pressurized by parents or anyone, and don't try to do things that you don't like, right? So just because of pressure, don't get settle into some kind of a job that is not giving you any satisfaction. I think after preparing for UPSC for 4 to 6 years, you will have so much of knowledge, you will have so much of innovative thinking, if at all you start thinking in that way, that you can actually explore many avenues.
And you also have that courage, after you fail so many times. I think failure, it's no longer taboo for us. You accept it, you grow from it, and you just move forward. You learn to move forward, actually.
See, there is so much fun in proving people wrong. Not intentionally, with consciously. Today, they see you as nothing. Haven't achieved anything or something. But after a certain time, they all come back to you, they start respecting you, they start inviting you. Something that is happening with me, like total strangers, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm not taking anything for granted or anything. It's still part of the process. Good things will happen.
So be you just patient. Need to hang in there, be patient and persevere.
Hang in there and try to do everything, but without losing patience. Be ambitious all the time, even when you have fallen down. You must be ruthlessly ambitious.
So what's your mantra in life, sir? I think I know it, but I just want you to tell aspirants today. I think you keep telling us to think big, think big. Don't stop thinking big. Don't settle for, anything less than what you think you're capable of.
So that is the mantra, thinking big at the same time, not losing out, you know, the good things about life, family, right, children, spending time with them, at the same time having certain interest, hobbies. So you should not, ambitious doesn't mean, you know, by sacrificing these things. You can have both the worlds. At the same time, whatever you want to achieve, you can achieve, I think.
So who is your dream guest for the podcast? Like, who do you want to have here?
So podcast, I actually thought about it. Like, someday I would like to bring Donald Trump.
Okay, that is a surprise. No. Why Donald Trump, sir?
Amit Shah, maybe sometime. I really want to talk to him. Such a great personality. Achieved so much. A Prime Minister Narendra Modi.
Okay.
Him also.
Yeah.
And Karan Johar also.
Coffee with Karan and a little more light.
Karan Johar, to let him know that what kind of question he should actually ask guests. Maybe.
That's a good one. Anyone else, sir?
Alia Bhatt, maybe.
Okay. And why Alia Bhatt?
She's such a good actress, like Alia Bhatt.
Okay.
I like her acting. I like her also, but she's married.
So, and so are you, sir.
Huh?
So are you.
So I am also married, yeah. But yes. So then another dream guest would be Elon Musk.
Okay, that'll be a really great episode.
Of course, these
what do you want to ask him?
These things will never happen, but...
Why, sir?
No, I mean, you never know. What might happen, we don't know.
Yeah.
Will happen.
Yes.
We'll make it happen, maybe.
I'm sure you will, sir. So, would you like to end with a wonderful message to the students who are watching today, sir? I think they all love you so much. So we get huge amount of emails like, Vinay sir, so great, you know, I'm so fan.
You get
no, sir, I will show it to you, sir, with screenshots. Sure. Like, Vinay sir rocks, Vinay sir is great.
No.
So these are kind of messages we have, I'm saying it, students.
Okay. I've already given them so many messages, like Twitter and everywhere. Sometimes I feel like, who am I to give a message? Like, if somebody individually comes, then definitely I'd like to give it. I would like to give is that, they have to be fiercely ambitious, right? I think there is a difference between aspiration and ambition, right? Don't be just an aspirant. Be somebody who has ambition beyond IAS, right? Where you would really like to bring real change in the world by your work, by your thoughts, by your personality, by your ideas. So only then you will be able to sail through the small issues that you know, experience every day. And you won't even notice the small setbacks also when you are on a mission to achieve a bigger thing.
You shut the noise around you and just, you know, have single-minded focus.
The noise will be shut, you know, when you are ambitious. Yeah. When you really want to achieve bigger things, automatically noise will be shut. You won't care about any noise. You won't care about what people are saying, how people are judging, right?
Yes, sir.
Be somebody who is on a mission without compromising who you are.
Yes, sir. That's a wonderful message, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Vinita. It was really great talking to you and you really asked wonderful questions.
Thanks, sir.
I think you make a better host than me.
No, sir. I don't know what kind of feedback I'm going to get, but I will learn. We have a surprise for you. So this is a hamper by team A Little More Light, curated with a lot of love and light by us. So this is for you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Beautifully decorated by Manasa.
Oh, thank you so much, Manasa, ma'am.
So check this out, sir.
This is a powder bottle or what?
This is an LED candle, sir.
Thank you.
So it's safe also, child friendly.
This is soap.
Scented candle. Because you like good fragrances. And these are chocolates for you, sir. And this is for you, sir.
Oh, it's book.
Yes, sir.
Wow.
And what's on top, sir?
You are awesome.
You are awesome, sir.
Thank you. Is it a diary or what?
Yeah, it's for like you to write in, sir. We have a letter for you on the first page.
Okay.
And with your photos, sir.
So you put all my tweets here.
Yes, sir. It's a book of your tweets for you to write in also.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. Such a guy, kind gesture from your side.
You're welcome, sir. Thank you so much for being a wonderful teacher, a wonderful mentor, and now a wonderful boss. I think Team Insights, you know, we're so grateful to you because I think you're such a cool boss. You give us like 100% freedom, no micromanagement. And I think you encourage us to like just pursue our goals. So you're like this all-in-one, you know, the transition for us from being your ex-student to being now your employee.
Mm-hmm.
It's been great. So thank you so much, sir. It was a pleasure talking to you today. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for all the wonderful words.
You're welcome.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.